So good evening, everybody. Our second session of 2021. The first one was special. It was about the heart. It was about the human touch. And today, Pan and his mom are sitting and working very peacefully. And Pan keeps looking at mom, looking very hassled. And she says, you know, Pan, I'm really busy today. I have to make notes because there are going to be so many children tomorrow who I have to teach and I don't know what to do. So Pan said, what happened, mom? So she said, you know, I got a note from a parent that said that the child didn't understand anything. So Pan looked a little sad and he said, oh, really? And then she said, you know, I got another note from another parent. And he said that my child got really bored in the class. You were really slow. So one says you're really fast. One says you're really slow. I don't know what to do. So Pan kept thinking, what is mama going to do? And you know, we know as teachers what we go through. Somewhere the children are so fast. Somewhere they're a little slow. Somewhere they're just right. So what do we do as teachers? Who's going to help us out? We've all been researching, we've been reading, and what we've done in the last 10 months is nothing short of wonder. But still, I feel we need a little more support. We need to understand what else we can do to make our own lives a little easier. So I've been hearing a lot about the artificial intelligence and how it's going to help all of us. Now, I don't have much of an understanding of it still. I tried reading about it. So today I didn't sit with my chai ka piala, which was full. I'm sitting with a chai ka piala, which is empty today. That is why today I don't have a backdrop because I need to learn to make a good backdrop. So to help us to do that, we have Pradyut with us today. I'm going to introduce Pradyut in two ways to all of you. One is I'm going to read his, it's surprising that, you know, when you have young people at home, how little you know about their professions that carefully. So today I'm going to introduce Pradyut first as my son. My daughter is blessed to be married to this handsome man. So Pradyut, a very warm welcome first from home, and then I'll introduce you professionally.
Of course. Thank you so much, mom and ma'am, today.
great. Thank you. You know, this is what the whole Square Panda stands for, Pradyut. We had decided that we will build communities. And when you build communities, the best way to build communities is to look within.
True.
And that is one reason why, without a hesitation, I have introduced so many people who have been within my domain of influencing me, right?
True.
And, you know, and remember, so many conversations I've had with you trying to ask you, what is this all about?
Correct.
Yes. So correct. Now it's introducing Pradyut to all of you professionally. He's a B2B marketer, podcaster, author, guest speaker, currently heads product marketing at Netco Solution. He helps a lot of balancing of brands, connecting. That is what I understand of his work. And today he's here to tell us, he's also works with you know, what I liked about the last part of what he wrote is he's passionate about using technology to solve real world problems. I think that's what we are going to ask you to do for us, Pradyut. It's a challenge. Teachers are challenged. Situation is challenging. We don't know what to prepare for. If you tell us that, are you preparing for the future? I don't know what to prepare for. Every year I had that ability, right, as a teacher, right? I knew 4th of April school is going to open. I knew so many admissions are going to happen. There was a processing. Today, I don't know. So starting from there, we are going to request you to first help us to understand what is artificial intelligence. Yes. And then you have created a process about how you're going to help us to understand. So today, I'm not going to ask you too many questions. I'm going to request you to take us through the process. And today, for all the audience watching us, I'm going to leave the screen to this young professional to lead us and help us explore. So Pradyut, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that very warm welcome. Also, a big thank you to the Square Panda team as well for having me here. Now, the entire concept of artificial intelligence, it's gone beyond just being a buzzword. You know, it's a tangible reality, but there are so many myths and so many misconceptions that are attached to those two words when put together. So my objective here today is to bust some of those myths, give you a basic foundation to understand what AI is, what the implications it brings to the table when it comes to the education sector, and how it's of benefit to both learners and tutors. So I'm going to do my best, and I'm going to tell you right up front that artificial intelligence is not something to be feared or to be intimidated by. It's actually a pedagogy ally, and I'll tell you exactly how. But before we begin, I'd just like to break down what artificial intelligence is, right? So if I had to look at it from a very simple, simplistic, easy definition, it's actually just a backend algorithm that programs machines to emulate and extend human behavior and actions. What that means is it's actually a complex line of code or software or an algorithm that is created by us humans itself. We create this to ensure that machines then start replicating or mimicking what a human being might do, and then add another layer of intelligence to it so that it does something that humans may not be capable of doing at scale. And while it sounds slightly daunting on the surface, the entire definition, what we don't realize is that AI is all around us. You know, it has woven itself into the fabric of our everyday lives. Think about every time we launch YouTube to watch our favorite videos, or we launch Spotify or JioSaavn to listen to our favorite music. Think about every single time you go to Flipkart or Amazon to do your online e-commerce shopping. AI is there everywhere, because the homepage that I see for Amazon versus what Sonia ma'am would see on Amazon would be very different. It would be based on her past purchase history, her browsing history, the products that she purchases the most versus what I would do as a unique individual. So we have AI all around us. Think about the intelligent voice assistants and speakers that we have these days, right? Whether it's on your phone, you have Siri on the Apple devices, you have your Amazon Alexa sitting at home. These are all examples of how AI has actually pervaded our everyday existence, and we don't even quite realize it. So that's one thing that I wanted to, you know, bring right to the table at the onset, telling you that this is not something to be overtly afraid of. The foundation of AI is obviously the quantity and quality of data that AI systems generate and collect. So that is precisely the foundation on which these systems, you know, become scalable. And if you remember right at the beginning, I said that it's not something to be feared or intimidated, something that you should be intimidated by, especially when you're on the teaching side of things or you're a parent. It's actually just a supplementary tool that is widely capable of simplifying the lives of teachers and learners alike. So that's just a brief on what AI is all about, how it's become part of our daily lives. What I want to tell you now is, you know, some of those four or five use cases, or should I say applications of artificial intelligence, predominantly in the education sector. And I'm going to make it very relatable, because you'll notice how the application of AI is solving actual problems that teachers and learners are dealing with on a day-to-day basis. So if you look at it from that particular prism, I call it the ALTAG model. So it actually is helping you simplify administration, learning, tutoring, assessing, and grading. You know, if we were to look at it as a nutshell, those would be the five places where AI can actually help, you know, both teachers and learners. To begin with, when I say administration, I mean that teachers today get bogged down with so many manual tasks, and that takes away from a lot of their bandwidth that they can actually devote towards teaching their students, right? So whether it is assessing homework or providing valuable feedback to their students, etc., it's a manual task. But with AI involved, it can actually automate a lot of these administrative duties, not just for teachers, but for academic institutions as well.
In fact, when I'm listening to you, it's a small thing like calculating the attendance.
Correct.
I have been a teacher. This is my 31st year and been teaching actively now for about at least 25 years. And I remember the time when I used to really dislike this whole process was when I had to do my calculations.
Right.
And I would exchange this in barter.
Right.
I would tell people, I'll do up your theme board, but please do my calculation for me.
Correct.
So I think I'm beginning to already see that. Imagine if I had something to do it for me. Maybe it would have just... And then, the worst part used to be when they asked me to do comparison month-wise. Oh, my
right.
God. It used to really harass me. So, I think it's a very...
Absolutely. Because those are such mundane, monotonous, manual tasks that you don't actually need... You're not even using your brain that much to do it. It's just that it's taking up so much of your time and bandwidth. But with machines being able to do it, it's not just computing attendance, but they can actually predict who are the students who are most likely to maintain that particular good attendance or bad attendance as well. So AI comes with a predictive modeling capability, which means that over a period of time, if you see certain... let's take the example of attendance itself. If you see someone's attendance dropping week on week, month on month, the AI, when backend integrated into a system, can actually raise a red flag and say that, these are 5 students in your class whose attendance is dropping week on week, and probably there is corrective action that needs to be taken from the teacher's point of view as well. The operational efficiencies that AI brings into the picture are phenomenal. Something as simple as, I'll give you another example. When it comes to examinations, right, there are so many space constraints, or it's a manual task and a logistical nightmare also to, have, maybe not in the COVID times, but back in the day when there were physical exams happening in schools, etc. How do you fit so many people into XYZ number of classes, right? But with AI in the picture, it can actually say that, okay, this is one area or one classroom where there is extra space, or there are an extra number of benches or tables available. Of course, you have to model it that way, but it will basically highlight things that manually you will not see, or you will take far too much time to see those patterns, trends, or concepts.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I think it's fabulous because, as you're talking,
right,
I'm beginning to recollect all the times we used to go running one class after the other.
Correct.
Corrective patterns, another thing which I'm really liking, that you're helping me to anticipate and create a readiness pattern for the teachers to get ready for what we may see in future. The first question that I asked you.
Yes.
That, I don't know. So are you going to... So just imagine, I like this word, predictive modeling capability. These are all new things for me, but I'm liking them. I'm noting them down, and I'm going to definitely try and connect them to our coming sessions, So we'll just keep going on. And you'll have to keep excusing me intervening.
No, please do.
I am getting superly excited and happy, understanding, oh my God, my life is going to become that much easier.
I mean, fingers crossed, if done right, the, the benefits are exponential. And I hope the audience as well is, realizing that the true power of AI lies not just in recognizing and adopting technology, but it's about also harnessing it responsibly. Because you cannot outsource everything to technology and just say that AI will help me do this. That's just one aspect of it. This is something that I wanted to say right at the onset also, that humans and artificial intelligence basically have to work, or technology have to work hand in hand. That's the only way that they can unlock true value at both ends of the spectrum, whether it's on the teacher side or on the learner side, right? Another key area that I wanted to highlight and very, very important from both the tutor and learner perspective is the use of smart content. What that means these days is that, especially during these times when a lot of learning is happening remotely in the absence of physical classrooms and teaching, so you have actual physical textbooks for various subjects that are being very rapidly digitized. A lot of the syllabus, a lot of the content is now being transitioned to digital media, right? Whether it's through textual content, whether it's through videos, whether it's through other image related teaching assets, etc., right? So a lot of that has gone digital, which means that AI in this case can actually create summaries for each of these chapters. They could create flashcards, they could also come up with practical tests that are relevant to each and every student, which means that the parent syllabus or the parent textbook remains the same, but with AI it can actually personalize the entire learning journey and experience for every single student. So I'm going to come to that a little bit further on, but what I'm trying to get at is the power of AI ensures that there is a personalized learning experience for every single student. And I'll tell you why that's important, and ma'am, you can also chime in here, because the way our education system is structured, and it's not specific to a particular board, it's just generally across the spectrum, where traditionally our education system caters to the middle of the bell curve. If you look at it that way, it caters to that 80% of every single class across every single year. What happens is that 10% of those at the bottom who struggle to understand concepts or whose learning journeys are slightly more complex or who get left behind, you have 10% of those. And then you have 10% of the folks in each class who are probably far ahead of their normal learning curve, and they get neglected or they get bored. Yes. That was part of the story that you brought on the table initially.
In fact, Pradyut, this has been about in the coming sessions. There's another very dear friend of mine coming on board, and she works with special needs. Right. All right. So I gave her a call and I told her that, can you do one of the sessions for us? Mm-hmm. And I started imagining special needs as my brain is attuned to imagine it. Now, so she told me, she said, yeah, we need to work with this. And whatever she mentioned was for children who were far above the expected learning standard. Mm. So for a second, I was not anticipating that.
Correct.
I was thinking she is going to tell, people with children with difficulties, this and that. So she said, do you realize that special needs are also of people who are exceptionally blessed or exceptionally talented? They right. also have a need which is beyond the ordinary.
Correct.
And what do you do in a classroom to really cater to it? So I think what you're saying about that 10%, also another thing which is actually, kind of it's registering, is that I am taking care of a common rung. True. I'm very concerned about children who are not achieving that particular point of learning. But where am I thinking about children who have excelled that point of learning?
Correct.
So I think what you're saying is very relevant, that what do we do to actually get our curriculums into place where these children can be taken care of. So we would really like to, you to talk a little bit more about this so that we start. Yes, please. And I'm sitting with this entire document of the NEP, which I keep opening and keep reading.
Right.
Every time I'm listening to a new topic, Pradyut, it is so amazing that a document of 68 pages is so well thought of.
Right. No, definitely.
It's helping us to register. Just imagine each topic that you all are talking about, I'm able to find connects now. So thank you.
I'm glad this is going to help us all.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm glad to be helping you connect the dots.
Yes, please. So we'll talk a little bit more on that.
Sure, of course. So the point I was talking about was personalized and adaptive learning. That's the term that the experts are using as well. We spoke about the 80-10-10, you know, split between these classes. But what I'm trying to get at is when AI is introduced, the teachers are not necessarily replaced, you know, but they are in a better position to perform by offering personalized recommendations to each student, which means that those at the top of the class, those in the middle of the class, those at the bottom of the class, each student or each learner is treated as a unique, separate individual. So your lesson remains the same, but the way you might teach it to that particular student, and of course, this is happening on digital platforms, one teacher is not doing it for multiple students, but the way that lesson is taught or that subject is taught and how it is taught, over what span it is taught, all of that becomes super customized. And along the way, you know, you have customized assignments, it could be assessments and other examinations that could happen. Also, students can get very targeted and customized feedback from the teachers also. So it's basically personalizing the entire learning journey and experience at a very individual level. And that's the power that AI brings to the table. Because with AI at the back end of any digital platform, it's collecting data on each and every individual learner. So that system is in a position to say that, okay, now is the time that now is a good time for the tutor to assess his or her learning for a particular subject at a particular time. The AI can then flag and say that, okay, these are the areas of improvement that that particular student requires. So it's a very customizable approach. And there are a lot of platforms and businesses out there today who are building such technology as well. So that's where the entire personalized and adaptive learning angle comes into the picture. One more aspect to this, ma'am, is that this same, you know, personalized learning experience can be extended to the tutors also, as in the teachers also need to be at a level to be imparting quality education, which means that AI in this case can actually help them get up to scratch as well. I'm sure you have some thoughts around this, so I'd love to take your views on this.
You know, Pradyut, I also work with teacher facilitation. And just yesterday, I was in a session and I realized that there were some teachers who were telling me, I know all of this. And there were some teachers whose eyes were telling me, we don't understand this at all.
Right.
So when I was talking to you a little bit earlier in the evening, I thought that just imagine if you know, I have access to the readiness levels of teachers also.
Correct.
Imagine even the way we facilitate them changes.
Absolutely.
You know, our design changes. And you know, the NEP has this very nice recommendation of minimum 50 hours of training per teacher.
Right.
Now, in the first year, we may all be on a common ground. Let's just assume that it's a common ground for everybody being a beginner year. But in fact, next year, when some people are going to pick up much more, going to do more research, going to work more, then their readiness level will not be the same next year. We will have to think of other things to do.
Yes.
And I think what you're saying is so relevant, because also when I train teachers year after year after year, I realize that somewhere I'm unable to have data where I can go back and say that let me not do this year because I've done it for the last 4 years.
Correct.
You know, so I think, yes, as facilitators, as teacher training programs, it's definitely going to help us to think differently.
True.
And I'm going to start looking for these tools very quickly now.
Oh, please do, because, you know, a lot of businesses, as I said, are creating platforms like that. They are aware that this is the need of the hour. It's just a question of bridging that comprehension gap. You know, there are academicians, there are educational institutions who are still not convinced that this is the way forward. It'll take some, you know, bold people to, you know, jump, take that plunge and actually become pioneers in this space. And then they become torchbearers for the adoption of such technology. But yeah, go on.
You have to be careful when you give us these suggestions, because if we take them, then we will get after you young people to help us out.
I'd be more than happy to.
So for all the educators, we know where we can go, right? Okay, so we'll go ahead, you know, lovely. And we will need to, like, for example, I always say that you need some crazy people in the world who can believe that they can change the world.
Correct, absolutely.
Because they can, you know, so you have to, and in fact, today my inviting you was for this purpose, that I was not myself understanding enough to make other people understand.
Right.
You know, so today I'm like already thinking. So yeah, that's the beginning.
Awesome. All right, I'm glad you had me over. Yeah, so one very, very interesting point I wanted to make, and which is very relevant to the Indian economy and context, is the fact that we are a multilingual, culture, and the way education is imparted will always be multilingual.
Very much so.
Right. And there's an angle of artificial intelligence called natural language processing, which means that a teacher today may not have to know multiple languages at the same degree of proficiency. With AI in the picture, they can actually rely on that technology to help them impart that, you know, those lessons or that content far better, without having to be as proficient in those multiple languages. So that's another interesting facet to all of this.
It's not only interesting, but imagine every session I take,
right,
people tell me that, with the NEP saying that we need to actually take care of the mother tongue. So I was doing a storytelling session for the Army school teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And just out of, you know, curiosity, I asked them, so tell me at any one point of time, how many languages could a child, you know, how many children in their classroom had, how many languages that could be spoken in the class?
Mm-hmm.
So mother tongue. So she looked at me and she smiled and said, you know, there was this hand up and she said, I need to speak, you know, like I want to come on video.
Right.
And she said the maximum number of languages, a mother tongue spoken in my class at any one point were almost 24. That means from 24 different states, there were children in that school. And she said, and we just smiled and we didn't know, you know, what to answer to her. She said, what language should I speak, madam? In which language should I tell story? I said, oh my God, I don't have an answer to this. So you're actually giving us a answer to that, you know, that it could just help us to. And also our languages are complex. It's not like we can just go and learn a language. And plus what happens for people in transferable jobs? These are all challenges. And, you know, perhaps we would understand it because from the defense, our children travel so much.
True.
So, yeah, I think it's a perspective. You know, today, Pradyut, we also have a lot of heads watching us. We have a lot of people from different parts of the country who've joined us, who are actually going to be able to, you know, look for solutions now that we are talking about them. So I'm sure inputs are going to come and we'll take one step ahead. I'm making my notes, but, you know, I'm just so, I'm so engrossed in listening to you that today I may not be able to compile the notes also at the end. So I'm going to.
No.
But thank you so much. It's giving us very, very good perspective.
No, I'm glad. So a lot of these points are actually coming to me on the fly while we are having this conversation also. Because what happens is from an industry standpoint, they think of a finite number of applications. But what's important is that each application needs to be mapped out to an actual problem. And those problems and challenges come from on-ground practitioners like you. And a lot of the other folks on this particular session as well.
Yeah, I like this perspective of yours. When you say finite, objective or finite, vision. So we have a concept in our in early years where at the end of every topic, we are supposed to give learning outcomes.
Right.
And I always, hesitate in giving a specific learning outcome because just like you're saying, that sometimes while I'm teaching the same page, If I have a finite, a defined learning outcome, then I only teach that much.
Right.
So what you're saying is so correct, that once you start applying it, once you start using it, their finite will become infinite by usage.
No, absolutely. Absolutely.
Right. So yes, it's relevant. I mean, I'm big. I'm actually now getting to see the connects. I can have my chai now.
All right, great. Yeah. So,
okay, so we'll go ahead.
Sure.
To the next
sure.
point.
So those were actually some of the key points that I wanted to touch upon. What I also wanted to highlight was the fact that artificial intelligence is as good as the quantum and quality of data that the system is ingesting, which means that there should not be over-reliance on technology, and expectations also need to be aligned in a certain way. You know, it's not to say that just by adopting artificial intelligence, we're going to be producing geniuses by the dozen. That's not how it works, actually, because one must remember that artificial intelligence, those algorithms at the back end, are programmed and created by humans like us only. So the technology is only going to be as robust and as good as, you know, we build it, and how our expectations are also aligned to the adoption to such technology. So that was another point that I wanted to bring to the table. Ma'am, you're
so,
on mute.
This is, I think, also very, very correct about anything that you're taking on in any field. We are actually also watching this whole digital space. You know, the last 10 months has made digital life come alive for people who never even thought they're ever going to
absolutely
touch it. I mean, they're people.
Correct.
I remember I've been facilitating teachers for now 17, 18 years, 70,000 teachers. And there were times when people would just look at me and say, no, we don't do this. I used to say, ma'am, just open it and see it. You know, just open. So she would say, no, I'm good with it. And today I see every single person. What is also very interesting is that we are talking of stratas of the society.
Absolutely.
Every strata is now getting equipped. So the kind of awareness they are going to have, the kind of readiness they are going to have, is definitely going to be much more than we've seen before, you know, when we all actually come back. And another thing, you know, Pradyut, which I thought I must ask you is,
sure,
when we come back and we in fact, what come back, when we prepare for the future, you know, the next few months, is this also something that, you know, where we can actually put our data into a place saying that these were the number of activities we did, this the children responded to, this needs to be tweaked a little. You think all this is also possible by using a data processing with an AI?
Absolutely. It's very much doable. And this becomes a, you know, it's almost like a 360 degree view on individual students. So one of the things that the NEP also outlines is that they want to create a digital report card for every
yes.
student throughout their entire learning journey from kindergarten onwards to graduation.
Yes, yes.
So that, you know, sort of like falls into this particular use case that you were mentioning, and it's definitely doable. It's just that the technology required to put into place, it requires a sizable amount of investment. A lot of trial and error will go into testing it. And we've to see how we can extend this across, you know, different socioeconomic stratas, because it's different for a private school to implement such a thing at that scale, but to allow that to trickle down to public, the entire public education system,
yeah.
that is going to be the major challenge.
I also see, while you're talking, I also see this as a very, very important bridge the gap between people who can afford to create these systems vis-a-vis the support we need. You know, like Devi say, when we talk about, you know, development of children, we talk about needing nurturing and care. We never say not good enough.
Right.
So what I'm also looking at is that the systems that have applied it well at the initial stages can actually share data with people who are beginning to do it at a little later stage.
Oh, absolutely. Because, you know,
right? So,
absolutely.
Yeah, their experience. And plus also what I'm now beginning to imagine is we can also feed in the fact that our children started at this level. Our teachers started at this level. This is the level we find them, 10 months from when we applied it. When you start at that point of time, perhaps these are the things you can expect.
Yes.
These are the trouble areas, and this is how you can solve it. So does all this come under this domain too?
Yes, absolutely. That's the entire predictive modeling capability that I was talking to you about. The more data that an AI actually ingests over a period of time, the more pointed the predictive capabilities and more fine-tuned they become. So as you mentioned, let's say there's a sample size of students in classes 1 and 2, maybe for a couple of subjects. Over a period of time, the AI will be able to say that for this particular strata, for this particular age group, this is what the key result or key, you know, learnings should, that's where the learning curve should be at the end of 6 months, at the end of 12 months. So that predictive angle definitely kicks in. And it's, as you mentioned, you know, that entire data sharing angle comes into the picture. It's also, you know, those adopting it have to embrace it wholeheartedly. It cannot be a piecemeal approach where they say that, okay, let's give this a shot. We'll see it because everyone else is doing it. So that's another angle I wanted to bring to the table, where there needs to be something called 100% buy-in from everyone, all stakeholders.
I think that holds good for anything in education. So when I work with early years, so I always tell them, you know, y'all pick up the curriculum in piecemeals. Mm. You'll pick up something of math, you'll pick up something of Hindi, you'll pick up something of somewhere, and then you expect the end result to be a prediction of what the entire usage should have been. So if you pick up parts, you will get results in parts.
Yes.
You're not going to get the whole result, right?
Correct.
So this is something which I have been kind of like I'm such a strong believer of it. If you adopt a process, then do it from the heart, mind, soul, hands, everything around you. Learn about it, work hard, just make it work, you know? Because finally, like, for example, I'm listening to you and thinking that, you know, what I'm holding is the key principles of the new the national education policy.
Right.
It says respect for diversity and local content. Mm. So if I'm sitting in Delhi, I have to be ready to be working with some place, maybe in Shillong, in Kerala, in Srinagar. It's amazing.
Right.
Equity and inclusion. Amazing, because I have to include every level, every kind. Community participation. We talked about sharing. We talked about processing data. We talked about my situation having this, but you can have this.
Right.
Use of technology, removing language barriers. You were speaking about
it. Yes, correct.
Okay. Emphasize conceptual understanding rather than rote learning. You talked about customizing, targeting specific needs and creating the observation sheets, right?
Yes, yes.
Unique capabilities. We talked about how we can identify that this child has this trend. These are the 5 things the child typed. These are the 10 words the child learned. These are the words the child is never needing to hesitate on. Mm. This child is seeing hesitate. You know, these are very minute details to be caught by the human eye.
Yeah, even recording, reading speeds, etc. also, right?
Reading speeds, hesitating. So I just did a phonic course, and there is a document that says observation of reading difficulties. Right? So imagine if I have a progressive record of what the child began with.
Right.
How we maneuvered the child and how did the child gain, and now what all we need to do, maneuver the child a little more. Maneuver. I think
do it for the next child also on that journey,
right? So yeah, and you know, so I also want to ask you, okay, sure. And one more thing that was here was critical thinking and creativity. logical decision making and innovation. You know, what I liked about what you said was that don't be over predictive about a data that is being fed and is going to give you results.
Right.
You will have to innovate. You will have to still be flexible. You will still have to adapt it. And I think that's one part which I really like, because we look at a technology thing and say, final solution. All children coding will become coders tomorrow.
Right. That's not how real life works.
It doesn't work. So I love that real life part of it. And continuous review based on sustained research, regular assessment by educational experts. That means I can take my data and just not only grade the children, I can mail it off to an educational expert who analyzes this for me and gives it back to me. What a beautiful process, right?
Right. That entire cycle can actually be, it's something that we call a flywheel. Once you set it in motion, it's an engine in constant function. So Absolutely. So that's the capability that technology with AI along with it can bring to the table. It's just a question of realizing that humans and AI or technology have to coexist, something that we call humanizing artificial intelligence. So, you know, because at the end
of the day, I like that a lot.
Right. Because at the end of the day, a student, a teacher, that human connect cannot be replaced, regardless of how much ever technology you bring into the equation.
I think this is going to put a lot of people also, people like us who've been like, now it's been 3 decades. When we started, there was no technology and we still managed very beautifully, right?
Right.
And I still say that about experience. That when I, in so many years of, as I grew my work, I started using a lot of digital in my teacher training.
Right.
And I would tell them that, you know, initially I used to carry 2 suitcases full of material.
Mm-hmm.
And I would show it to the teachers. I would open it out and I would exhaust myself.
Right.
And I would not be able to cover as much as I wanted to.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Then the e-resources happened. And even then I used to carry from 1 to 2 to 1 suitcase. And I've done that for the last 10 years.
All right.
Just day before yesterday, I was looking at my suitcase and saying, you know, I will not carry so much anymore. And yesterday in the session, I was able to do much more because I had it all at my, at my fingertip.
Right.
But the fingertip was mine.
True. True.
So what you're talking about, the human touch, I picked up what I felt was relevant, what I could connect. So I think that is how we are going to look at it. And that's how we are going to go ahead. Also, we are looking at a lot of what you said was also to be a little cautious as to what products we are picking up,
true,
what kind of processes we are banking on. And so I suppose as we keep using it or as we keep looking for these processes, we will be able to understand them better, Pradyut.
100%.
What should I choose to make my school better equipped where teacher training is concerned? So as I keep slotting it in my own mind that can this be done? Can this be connected? So what I'm going to suggest to all of us watching today is let's write out our list of questions. Can we use this for this purpose, right? Another thing that let's list out is what are the areas which are mundane, which really don't need a very, creative brain, which is a repetitive activity, which takes away time of our teachers. So if we start with just these 2 things where all the repetitive patterns are put onto one side and we create a process for it, and the questions we want answered on the other side, then we start looking for solutions. We start training our teachers to adapt those solutions, internalize those solutions and apply those solutions, right? Then we have systems where these teachers who are applying are also being monitored so that we see their abilities of application getting better and better.
Absolutely.
So our support to them becomes, then we modify our support to them. This is just the beginning of my understanding, Pradyut. I don't know whether I'm thinking it right or not.
You are absolutely on the right track. I am so glad that I was able to simplify the entire complex, concept so that you were able to connect the dots and create that foundation. I hope I've been able to do that for the rest of the audience
I hope so too. Normally what happens is when we are all on a topic which all of us know, we keep typing comments, all right?
Right.
So when it's a topic like this, very few comments will come.
Right.
Because everybody is listening.
Right.
You know, everybody is just absorbing and listening. And I know because I've seen these reactions over the past 35 plus weeks, you know, where it's so wonderful that we are actually having an audience that just doesn't put in a comment because and I'm seeing people listen because after they listen, the kind of things they write to us that, oh, this was applicable, this was applicable. I think that's where we are, we have to thank you for keeping it simple. Normally, it's complicated and people make it sound so.
And mind you, it is actually complicated. I've just merely scratched the surface. There's a lot of, tech jargon that goes behind explaining most of these concepts. But what's important, I think one final thought I want to leave all of you with is, this very nice quote that I swear by. All change is hard at first. It is messy in the middle and it is glorious in the end. So if you open up your mind to the possibilities of what technology can do for you, then the sky is the limit. But on the same hand, on the other hand, in fact, temper your expectations. See what works for you the best as an educational institution, as an academician. And once you hit that sweet spot, technology can become a real enabler.
Thank you, Pradyut. And, for everybody who's watching us, next week we have somebody who's going to talk to us about inclusive learning. And we'll connect the dots. We'll definitely try and connect what Pradyut was telling us about data, about how we manage our resources, to what Monica is going to speak to us about inclusion of different kinds of learning aptitudes and what we can do to make them better. So, Pradyut, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having
very,
me.
Very, very proud of you.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And, also it's going to be interesting because the SquarePanda platform themselves, they are actually looking at creating these kind of resources for the users. So I'm sure their teams will come and talk to, the people about it a little later. But it's a lovely beginning. And thank you. And
thank you. Thank bye-bye. You so much.
Thank you.
Square, square, p-p-panda.